Test, test. A good afternoon, everyone. If we could all start to slowly find our way to our seats so we can start on time. Again, hi, everybody. If we could all slowly start to find our way to our seats. Thank you.
I'm not just channeling Carl Levin here. I really need these. Well, good afternoon. I'm Jim Townsend, and I'm the director of the Levin Center for Oversight and Democracy here at Wayne State University. It is my honor to welcome you to this celebration of the life and legacy of Senator Carl Levin. After these many months during which we could not come together as we wanted to, We are so grateful to be able to be here with you today. We at the center are honored and deeply touched to have been asked to collaborate with the Levin family to arrange today's celebration. Senator Levin,
or
Carl, as he insisted that we all call him, established the Levin Center with the help of former staff members and leaders at Wayne State University upon his retirement from the U.S. Senate in 2015. The center's mission is to advance Carl's legacy by championing bipartisan, fact-based oversight, civil discourse, and truthfulness as fundamental pillars of our democracy in Capitol buildings, communities, and classrooms around the country. Jocelyn Benson, Michigan's Secretary of State, who was the dean of the law school and the founding director of the Levin Center, told me, and I quote, "You'll never regret working for Carl Levin," unquote. Now, I've known Jocelyn for quite a few years, but I didn't know at the time she had such a gift for understatement. Working for Carl Levin has deeply affected my life and my career and given me hope, even in these times, about what our country can become if we return to the task to which Carl Levin devoted his career, that of relating the work of government to the people, all the people, and to following the facts wherever they lead. Our program today will consist of three parts. We'll have three groups of speakers with video interludes taken from the floor of the U.S. Senate with comments from Senator Levin's colleagues. Everyone here is also well, I've skipped ahead in the program here. Our first group of speakers will include friends, family members, and constituents whose lives were deeply touched by Carl's love, mentorship, caring, and service. We begin with Carl's friend, Eugene Dreiker.
I first met Carl Levin in 1965 when, as neighbors on Renfrew Road in Detroit, we were introduced by our wives who had known each other for years. There was certainly nothing at that time to signal that Carl would someday become one of the most respected elected officials in Michigan history. He was then general counsel of the Civil Rights Commission, an early tip-off that serving the public good would be his passion. But lots of fine people enter public service. Few earn the admiration of a Carl Levin. What was it that so endeared him to millions who never met him and who didn't necessarily share his political views? Let me suggest a few possible answers. First, Carl was the quintessential family man. At every opportunity, he spoke in reverential terms about his parents, Sol and Bess, and the influence they had on him. Carl's love for his siblings, Sandy and Hannah, and of course for his wife, Barbara, and their three daughters, Kate, Laura, and Erica, was a subject he regularly spoke about unabashedly. And as his children married and had children of their own, Carl took particular pleasure and pride at the accomplishments of his grandchildren. Carl's open way of expressing love of family resonated with the public, many of whom were unaccustomed to seeing such a show of affection from elected officials. Carl was thoughtful. He never failed to thank those who helped him, often with a handwritten note of appreciation. He lavished praise on his staff, who adored him and worked miracles to help advance his ambitious goals. And Carl's concerns about those who struggle to make a living translated itself into personal generosity. his larger-than-normal tips to the waitresses at Buddy's Pizzeria on 6 Mile Road regularly put everyone else at the table to shame. Carl loved Detroit and wore his pride on his sleeve. Even in its darkest times, Carl never gave up on his hometown, and especially on his beloved Red Wings and Tigers. Generations to come will enjoy the Riverwalk, not knowing that it was built because Carl brought home a multi-million-dollar earmark that was instrumental in returning the riverfront to ordinary Detroiters, for whom Carl devoted so much passion. Carl cared deeply about people and their problems. Those of us who ever ate at a restaurant with him will recall a waitress or a patron from another table rushing over to thank him for help with an immigration issue or a Medicare problem. And if the encounter involved a new request, Carl invariably dug into that bulging dress pocket of his shirt and pulled out yet one more index card on which to scribble a note to attend to this plea for assistance. Carl had a fine sense of humor that was often displayed in self-deprecating ways. Just as he was retiring from the Senate, where colleagues were singing his praises, he laughingly told of a woman who came running up to him, asking, "Aren't you Carl Levin?" When he smiled broadly and acknowledged his identity, her reply was, "Well, go screw yourself." How many public figures would puncture their own balloons in this way? Coupled with Carl's sense of humor was a total lack of a sense of style. Carl elevated indifference to how he dressed to a high art form, and he made sure that image was never tarnished by a neatly pressed suit, a spotless raincoat, or a finely stitched belt. For casual attire, Carl rolled up the sleeves of his dress shirt and loosened his tie, and that was it. Carl's devotion to the public good was limitless. As one of the lawyers for the state of Michigan in the Flint water cases, I witnessed firsthand his Herculean effort serving as a court-appointed mediator to get these cases settled, even as his health declined. After that settlement was achieved, Carl phoned me late one night, less than 2 weeks before his death, to be sure that an affidavit he had submitted to the court satisfactorily conveyed his support for that settlement. That was the last time the two of us spoke. And the call remains etched in my memory. Only Carl, in the last days of his life, would both worry about and act upon this kind of concern. These are but a few, but by no means all, of the endearing characteristics of Carl Levin, a full description of which would take up the rest of this program. Simply stated, Carl was a mensch. The people he represented could relate to him, regardless of their politics. Perhaps more importantly, they witnessed how profoundly he could and did relate to them. It was that bond of mutual respect and affection that allowed Carl, with his extraordinary legislative skills, to accomplish so much during his more than 4 decades of public service. Our city, our state, and our nation are so much better because of the remarkable life of Carl Levin.
Good afternoon. I'm Erica Carl. I'm Barbara's youngest daughter. It's so nice to see all of you here today. Laura and I are going to take a guess that most of us here could name five things off the top of our heads that Dad loved. As his kids, we can name many more than that, so we're going to ask for a little of your indulgence and give you a snapshot. Let's start with the obvious. He loved his family, his friends, his staff, his colleagues, his constituents, and of course, the city of Detroit, the state of Michigan, and the United States. And then some of the slightly less obvious things. Dad loved classical music. He loved to read, he loved photography, and he was a great photographer. He loved listening to Mom play the piano. He had a ball looking things up on Google, watching movies, laughing to the point of tears. He loved wildlife, astronomy, collecting autographs, and spending time outdoors. And food, lots of deep affection there. Dad loved pie, stuffed cabbage, soup, Buddy's pizza, anything grown in Michigan like cherries, blueberries, and corn, and cookies, preferably chocolate chip, and from a bakery or a box, it didn't really matter. We could go on and on, but we won't, because in truth, the list is endless. And the reason for that comes down to a simple principle. Dad loved his life. Dad just loved living, seizing every moment, and that was something that as his daughters, we knew from a very young age. Whether he was playing pickle with us in the front of the house, or taking us to see a Red Wings or Tigers game, or dragging us out to pick apples in Livingston County. Whether we were heading out on a car trip to Niagara Falls, or going down I-75 to grab a copy of the Detroit Free Press as it rolled off the printer at 10 o'clock at night, Dad made the most of every minute, and watching him in action, being part of the action, was a blast because Dad was so much fun. In fact, as kids, we could never wait for him to come home from his job on the city council, and we would walk all the way to 8 Mile Road just so he could pick us up and we could spend an extra few minutes with him in the car. As the three of us grew older and Dad served in the Senate, his work life consumed him much more. But even though we had to sacrifice spending time with him, and Mom, you sacrificed the most. The four of us knew how much he loved his job. We watched him at home as he prepared for committee hearings, wrote floor speeches, calling his dedicated staff way past bedtime, ours, theirs, and his. We tagged along as he marched in parades, toured factories, campaigned for elections. We cheered him on when he debated, chaired, and gaveled to order in an institution he adored. He was always on the go, and he loved bringing us along for the ride. And what to say as Dad, what to say about Dad as Grandpa? The role added a whole new dimension to his incredibly full life. As Noah, Beth, Ben, Sammy, Bee, and Olivia will tell you, he loved nothing more than to see them, traveling with Mom to Ann Arbor, New York, and Pittsburgh, to attend tennis and lacrosse matches, softball games, piano recitals, or just to have dinner. He was always the first to jump up for a game of wiffle ball or hoops, or sit down for a board game, even if it was the Settlers of Catan, which he barely knew how to play. And he was the king of bad jokes and goofy magic tricks. The grandkids learned about local history in their own backyards as Grandma and Grandpa would take them in the car to places they never would have known otherwise, ending up in a bookstore, a museum, or a local diner that might have become a family favorite or more likely one to avoid in the future. But it was the trips to D.C. that were the most memorable because Dad enjoyed so much about the city and its rich history. There was nonstop activity, and it never got old to walk along the mall, visit the portrait gallery, or head to the FDR Memorial where they could pet the statue of Roosevelt's dog, Fala. And of course, the most fun of all, when Dad would take the grandkids to run around the Capitol. There, he would gleefully show off the building, but even better, show them off to his colleagues, his staff, the Capitol Police, and his friends in the Senate cafeteria, who rang up all the jumbo-sized cookies that he would buy for them. All those moments with him are seared in the grandkids' memories because Dad loved to have fun with them, make them laugh, or teach them something they didn't know.
So when thinking about paying Dad a tribute today and doing it as his daughters and on behalf of Mom too, we wanted to emphasize how he embraced his life, the one that we witnessed. But how Dad lived away from the office truly does connect to how he made a difference as a public servant. Ultimately, all that joy we saw in him as he lived his daily life sprung from a spirit of deep optimism. And it permeated everything he did. Dad loved to push himself and those around him, in part, we think, because he envisioned success. Not that if you pushed yourself, you got what you wanted. Not at all. It's just that Dad also saw failure as a form of success, because failure would help you learn something that might lead to a successful outcome in the future, or it would help you push harder next time, which was its own reward. Whether Dad was undertaking a low-stakes task, like trying to construct an ice rink on an uneven patch of concrete in front of our garage, or a high-stakes one, like working really hard with his colleagues to pass a defense authorization bill, he reminded us all that you could do good or maybe even great things if you saw the possibilities. In fact, Dad's optimism might even explain his long-standing commitment to bipartisanship. While Dad famously reached across the aisle because he found it necessary to get things done, we would argue that because he was such an optimist, he also saw that crafting a compromise would lead to a positive outcome for the most people. Dad fully appreciated that bipartisanship is a concept of great positivity, and it inspired him to speak about it with vigor, even as he spoke less and less when his health made that hard for him. The years of Dad's retirement happened to coincide with the biggest challenges that we'd ever seen him face. His cancer diagnosis came early in 2017, and the country took a sharp turn away from the civility that Dad stood for and even cultivated during his time in office. But even in those years of especially tough news, both personal and national, Dad managed to stay positive. He looked forward to traveling to his granddaughter's bat mitzvah, taking trips to Lake Michigan and up to Maine to visit his namesake ship and write his memoir. He had confidence that voters would fight off the threats to democracy in the 2020 election, and they did that. He was determined to mediate a favorable settlement for the kids of Flint and never stopped believing it would be possible. And in the final weeks of his life, he even continued to brainstorm an idea that he'd had 10 years earlier for a show called The Good News Hour that he wanted to pitch to public television. It was a show that would offer inspirational, feel-good stories because Dad held fast to the notion that everyone needed to remember the positive things that happen in the world to help us remain hopeful. And he was right. Until the end, he never let the pain he felt physically interrupt his optimistic thoughts for the people of the people and the country that he loved. There are so many things that we miss about Dad, but on that very long list, his optimism may be at the very top. What a gift it was to have someone seeing the positive as he did. Dad was so, so good at that, and he served as a fantastic role model in that department. While Erica and I are reasonably positive people, we don't naturally see the joy and good in the world as Dad did, which makes the task harder without him here to remind us about the importance of positivity. That being said, even though we miss actually hearing his voice, we still hear him, which makes us think all of you might too. Dad's optimism served as a mission statement to live by. Whether we're going to school every day, working at our jobs, or running a household, or a nonprofit, or a government, staying positive, especially when it's not easy, is the best way we can think of to honor his memory. When we think of half glasses, we'll always think of them on Dad, and we'll always think of them full. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Ben. I'm Carl and Barbara's grandson. I'm just going to say a few things as well. So as my mom and my aunt just told you, Grandpa used to do a lot of fun things with us. One of the things I enjoyed doing with him the most was playing tennis. I took up tennis when I was a little kid. So when Grandma and Grandpa would come visit us in New York, I used to drag Grandpa out to the courts and hit a few balls with him. Now, as some of you may know, Grandpa was actually a squash player, and he'd played for decades with Uncle Sandy. So adjusting to the rhythm of tennis was probably not so easy, especially when you're wearing a white button-down dress shirt. But beyond that, when you're a squash player, you have different strokes. You don't swing through your shots. It's all in the wrist. Grandpa knew he didn't have the chops to hit a big forehand, So instead, when we'd volley, he'd set me up by running me around the court, and then he'd hit this slice and come up with these nasty dinkers that would barely land over the net. Now, I was a pretty quick kid on the court. I'd been playing tennis since the peewees, so you'd think I'd realize his strategy and get to those balls. But no matter how hard I tried, I could just never quite reach his drop shots. So this is what it was. A 70-something-year-old man wearing clothes that he probably wore to the Capitol, outplaying his 10-year-old grandson who'd played tennis since he was big enough to hold a racket. It still makes me laugh to think about it, but I don't even think Grandpa expected to make those shots half the time. He'd always crack up when they went over. It's probably unsurprising to a lot of you that Grandpa was able to whip out a killer drop shot and make his grandson work so hard. But Grandpa was a tactician. He didn't have a Serena serve or a Federer forehand, but he did have the dinker, and when it went over the net, it worked without fail. So even though Grandpa wasn't exactly a tennis professional, I learned a lot about the game from him. By running me around with these crazy angles, he showed me how to set up a point. He was never the strongest or the fastest, but he was clever, punishing me time and time again with his strategy. Like Grandpa, I was never the biggest guy. I was never the tallest or the strongest on the court. But all these years later, I remember that I have other skills in my arsenal and that I can win points with my mind too. But most importantly, Grandpa taught me about more than just strategy. He taught me to smile on the court, to not take myself or the game too seriously. I think my favorite part of playing with Grandpa was the fact that it was just so much fun. And the truth is, I don't know how much fun Grandpa actually had playing tennis, but he loved that it was something we could do together. Grandpa reminded me to give my all on the court, but more importantly, to give my all in relationships. He always went out there with a spring in his step, and we'd leave the courts with new memories and inside jokes every time we played. To this day, when I have a club tennis match in college, I remember how much fun we'd have. Because of Grandpa, what matters to me the most is to live in the moment and to build memories with my teammates. And if I get lucky and hit a successful drop shot, I have a good laugh about it and remember my roots. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Bob Marins, and as Senator Levin used to call me, Bobby. Yes, I had the good fortune of knowing Carl longer than perhaps anyone in this room, with the exception of a few stray cousins. Our friendship began more than 70 years ago with a shared interest in baseball and stamp collecting. That friendship developed over the years and deepened over the years as we both married our respective wives, Judy and Barbara, produced a series of daughters, Kate, Gail, Laura, Pamela, and Erica, traveled together, and eventually served together on the board of the Detroit Riverfront Conservancy, which Carl joined soon after he left the Senate. Besides my long-term friendship with Carl, I was asked to talk briefly about his many contributions to the outdoor environment, particularly here in Michigan. As someone who grew up in urban Detroit, one would not expect that Carl Levin would become one of Michigan's strongest environmentalists during the period from the early 1990s to 2021. I suspect that Carl's early exposure to the outdoors at summer camps in Maine and Ontario had something to do with it. Each of these adventures with Sandy enabled him not only to hone his athletic skills, which were many, but to experience picturesque rural landscapes and pristine natural environments. Over the years, these seeds of environmentalism grew through trips to the Upper Peninsula, Michigan's lake shores, rural parts of Washtenaw and Livingston counties here in southeastern Michigan. As our senator, he saw the need to preserve these kinds of picturesque historic landscapes for future generations. Carl's initial foray into environmental activities as a senator were not in Michigan, but in Alaska, where he worked closely with, as a freshman senator, with Senator Henry Scoop Jackson from Washington. Together, they played a critical role in getting the historic Alaska Wilderness Bill passed through Congress. In Michigan, Carl devoted himself to legislation aimed at restoring and protecting the Great Lakes. Among his many accomplishments, he, along with Senator Debbie Stabenow, secured passage of the Great Lakes Legacy Act, which authorized funding for the cleanup of contaminated sites throughout the Great Lakes. There were several other initiatives related to protecting the environment for future generations. Let me mention just a few. In 1987, Carl introduced a bill that passed into law called the Michigan Wilderness Act, which became part of the National Wilderness Preservation System. In 2008, he, along with Senator Stabenow, were able to add the Pictured Rocks Lakeshore as part of this national preservation system. Similarly, Carl was instrumental, again, with Debbie Stabenow, in gaining wilderness protection status for the Sleeping Bear Dunes National Lakeshore, first established as a national park in 1970, thanks to the late Senator Phil Hart. Carl also worked closely with Congressman John Dingell in getting a bill establishing the Detroit River International Wildlife Refuge Establishment Act, first signed into law by President Bush in 2001. Perhaps his greatest achievement, and one which he was most proud, was the Detroit Riverfront. Carl's vision of having the river accessible to all Detroiters dates back to his days on the Detroit City Council. He was the only no vote when the proposal was brought before the council to build the Riverfront Towers apartments on the shores of the Detroit River. And for years following the construction of the towers, he was constantly exploring alternative ways of creating a pedestrian connection between the east and west sides of the towers. Soon after the creation of the Detroit Riverfront Conservancy in 2003, Carl was instrumental in obtaining significant federal funds for key infrastructure improvements that were critical to the success of the riverfront that we see today. In early June of last year, Carl and I, along with daughter Laura, visited the riverfront for the last time. He was clearly delighted to see the newly completed boardwalk in front of Riverfront Towers that provided a direct pedestrian link between the east and the west riverfronts. It was obvious that his vision for the riverfront had been realized. May his memory and his environmental contributions be a blessing to all of us in Michigan. Thank you.
Hello. Let me first begin by giving respect to the Levin family. Thank you for inviting me. And I especially want to say thank you to my good friends, Katie Levin, Sandra Levin, and Andy Levin. And I know this is not a political day, but Andy deserves all the support he can get. So let me tell you a little bit about my relationship with Carl Levin. I have had more jobs than you can count on all your fingers and all your toes. I have been a factory worker on the line. I have worked on overseas freighters. And 50 years ago, I helped establish an organization called Access. It was a one-room house. Everybody paid for it that worked there. Nobody got paid to work. And over the years, it became the Arab American organization. It's now in 22 cities and serves more than 500,000 people a year. Carl Levin was instrumental in that. We went to him over and over and over again for help, and he was always there. Later, I worked for Governor Granholm, now Secretary Granholm, as the director of the Department of Human Services. We served millions of people, and we were serving them during a very difficult time in Michigan. But we were able to get $50 more in food stamps for 2 million people. Carl Levin was instrumental in that, as well as Debbie Stabenow and John Dingell. So bless them. People ate because of them, and they ate because of Carl Levin. Later, when I went to work as an associate provost at the University of Michigan, Dearborn, Carl was always there. Every time I had a question, I didn't feel strange at all about calling a senator and asking him for his ideas. So let me say, Carl Levin was an advocate for working people. He was an ally to many in the Arab American community, which you wouldn't expect. But Carl Levin wasn't that way. Carl stood up for human rights, whether they were Arab or Jewish. And there we found a way to be together. Everyone had rights, he said, and we needed to protect them. And Carl certainly did. Many were the times I would come to him and ask him for assistance in legislation for low-income people, or for him simply to provide me with good advice and counsel on the questions of the day. And before answering, he would always say the same thing. What do you think? He always made me think about the question itself and whether the solution lie with outside information or with people who knew what was going on. Carl Levin knew that we all count, every single one of us, that we are, in fact, as I say on my radio show, planetary citizens, and that everybody on this planet had a place. His legislation that he authored touched so many, and that's part of why we love him, but we love him for his humanity. Carl Levin will be missed, but he's left us a legacy. That legacy includes the Levin Center, which is doing work every day. It includes the people that he talked to and helped. And because of that, we love him. I love him. Bless you, Carl Levin.
Thank you for inviting me to share a few recollections today of someone who I think about nearly every day as I do my work. And truly, when we lost Senator Levin, now almost a year ago, a light went out in Michigan that will never be replaced. It's difficult for me to find the words to express what Senator Levin and his lifelong dedication to our city, our state, and our country meant to me and to so many of us who are here today and others who seek to serve and lead during these uniquely divided times. My best days as dean at Wayne State Law School were when I got to work with and learn from Senator Levin. Indeed, when I was contemplating moving on to my next opportunity, the most difficult thing to think about leaving behind were the days when I could just walk down the hall and sit in his office and ask him questions, and he would, of course, listen more than he spoke, And always when he did share something, couple it with a brilliant, amazing story of some element of history that he was a part of and had witnessed. Yet whether it was co-teaching a class on legislation and leadership or launching the Levin Center in partnership with so many of you here today, or again, simply sitting in his office and asking for his advice, those days were among my most memorable of being at Wayne Law as dean. And when I told him that I wanted to run for Secretary of State of Michigan, he was unhesitatingly all in. There wasn't a time when he wasn't available to give me advice, to serve as a sounding board, to host an event, to call supporters, to even nominate me at not just one but two Michigan Democratic Party conventions. He was a constant source of wisdom and support, always encouraging me to lead courageously and always having my back. And Barbara, thank you for being there, right there along with him every step of the way. Similarly, I'm grateful for it. In our last conversation, which I remember clearly, and I think it was perhaps clear to both of us that that might be the last time we were speaking, I thanked him for writing his memoirs at a time when we all desperately need to learn more of how he served 36 years in the United States Senate and a lifetime in politics while remaining steadfastly humble, loyal, devoted, and kind. His commitment to service was everything we need from our leaders and so rarely get. I hope we can all ensure that in the months and years ahead, that his legacy lives on as all across the country, young men and women of all backgrounds and partisan affiliations can read his book, learn his story, and understand how he, throughout his entire life, put country, the Constitution, and truth above all else. I hope many will read that book and will learn of Senator Levin and be inspired to follow his example as future leaders. I know that what I see as part of my role today in this small time I may have as a leader is to play my part of telling his story and ensuring so many others learn and follow in his footsteps. As for me, I'll miss our lunches, our talks, and I will keep working every day to be a little bit more like him. I think if we all do that, we can honor his years of devotion to Michigan, to Detroit, to his family, and to his country. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Ibrahim Parlak. We all know what Senator Carl Levin did for his country, for Michigan, for working class, for middle class, also his devotion to the country, democracy, freedom, equality. We all know that. But there is a lot more to Carl Levin's life. What he did for strangers like me, for individuals. If he wouldn't have been Carl Levin, I wouldn't have been here probably. If he wouldn't have been Carl Levin, probably I would have been somewhere in a Turkish jail rotten, or if not killed. If he wouldn't have been Carl Levin, I wouldn't have seen then my 7-year-old daughter become adult, watching her grow day by day. It was him. It started all when I was held in Battle Creek, Calhoun County Jail. And one morning, sorry. When I was held there, I was introduced to all the guards, the jail workers, as a dangerous inmate. And they were all cautious when it came to me. And one morning, one of the guard, Kelly, day guard, walked and was like, "Look, Parlak, what I got for you." So I ran down the stairs. He handed me Carl Levin's press release, declaring me, saying that while everybody else was introducing me as a dangerous person, he named me as a model immigrant, that we need more people like him here in the United States. I just couldn't hold my tears. Went into my cell, just put my head to the pillow. That's how it started. After 10 months being held there, thanks to Judge Evan Cohn, I got released from jail and get a chance to meet Senator many times. And he introduced bills, private bills, one after other, to keep me here. And up to today, if it wouldn't have been all his efforts, his guidance, like I said, probably I would have been rotten somewhere in Turkey in some jails. And I'm really thankful for that. And I'm thankful to be here. I'm honored to be here. But one of the last time we met, after he announced his retirement, when he saw that I'm down, he put his hand on my shoulder. I'm retiring, but I'm not going anywhere. Yes, he didn't go anywhere. Every time when I called, he responded. He was always there. And now, he's not sitting with us. But I know he didn't go anywhere, just like he said. He's out there. He's watching over us. He's guiding us. And we are under his guidance in the strange world, in complicated world. We have to try to be better people under his legacy. Thank you.
It's no surprise to any of us that the first thing Carl Levin did when he spoke today was thank the staff, not just his own staff, but the police force and the groundskeepers and the food service people and the people that too many in this world ignore. That was the first thing he did. The second thing Carl did in his address was to talk about the gulf between the fortunate few and the struggling many. That has been what I most admire about Carl Levin, that he's always aware of that and always fighting the fight for people that have a lot less privilege than those of us do that dress like this and get really great titles. And no one, frankly, no one in this body has stood up to special interests and the most powerful forces in this town more effectively and more energetically than Carl Levin. And for that, I am so grateful. And I know so many of us in this country are so grateful. Thank you, Senator Levin.
When we seek advice, when we need a senator to help us understand something, we go to Carl Levin. I know some of my constituents have a hard time believing that we read the bills around here. Carl Levin reads the bills around here. He's found typographical errors in some of my legislation.
My only advice to anyone in this body is if you're ever invited to travel with Carl Levin, spend the prior 2 or 3 months in the gym. I have never been so exhausted in my life. And we would be at 10 p.m. after all-day meetings and touring of refugee sites, and Carl would be saying, can't we have another meeting? Isn't there someone else we can talk to? His absolute passion for information and data upon which to make decisions is, I think, exemplary.
Chairman Levin and I can both say the same thing, and people will hate me and they love him. I always wonder how you get by with doing that, but you do. So he is a lovable guy that I will sincerely miss in that relationship, and I hope that you'll be back often so that you can be here to remind other people what a real statesman is.
This is the best of this institution of how it performs. It has been embodied in the public service of Carl Levin for 36 years here. What you have heard is the testimonies on both sides of the aisle that because of how he has conducted himself as an individual and how he has conducted himself as a public servant and how he has conducted himself as a leader in this Senate is exactly how this institution is supposed to function. Because he is all of the things that you've heard, the consummate gentleman, the humble public servant, the razor sharp mind, the best lawyer, by the way, in the entire Senate. The future Senates should take a lesson from the life and the leadership of Carl Levin of Michigan.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Kate Levin Markell, and I'd like to add a welcome from our mom, Barbara, and the entire Levin family. Dad's extraordinary legacy of accomplishments is, in fact, shared by many, hundreds of talented, hardworking public servants across Michigan and DC. So as we celebrate Dad and his special gifts, let's also acknowledge all of the staff gathered here, watching from home, and those who have left us, who together did so much for Michigan and Michiganders, for our country, our democracy, and democratic aspirations abroad. Senate families and staff spend a lot of time together. In our case, at events, over countless calls, binders dropped off at the House late at night, meeting up at highway exits to relay Dad between official and personal trips in Michigan, and visits to DC and Detroit offices, eventually with our kids. Over the decades, we had the true pleasure of getting to know some of the finest people you will ever meet, some of whom you will hear from now. And our final speaker in this next group is a veteran reporter, Kathy Gray, whom we invited to reflect on covering Dad as a member of the press. Chuck, you're up.
Thank you, Kate. My name is Chuck Wilbur, and I served Carl in three distinct capacities. My longest service was as his state director here in Michigan. I did a short stint as chief of staff on kind of an interim basis in Washington, and I managed two reelection campaigns, one in 1996 and one in 2002. I think every single person I know that worked for Carl considered it one of the honors, the greatest honors of their lives to have been part of that effort. And it's an honor to speak with you today. It's also a little daunting, I have to admit. I've done a lot of writing in my career, and without question, the most demanding editor I've ever had was a certain senator from Michigan. But as much as I learned from that experience, I wasn't confident I could trust my own words to illuminate a life that shines so brightly on all of ours. So instead, I want to share with you two of my favorite Carl Levin stories, stories that I think speak directly to the qualities that made Carl the unique and important political leader he was. The first begins in the summer of 1996. The reelection campaign is filming an ad in a staff member's suburban garage. Carl wasn't dressed in the uniform others have described earlier, that white business shirt, but instead in a plaid sports shirt the campaign had bought for the occasion. He has a broom in hand. "Is your garage a mess?" he asks. "Well, the Pentagon is even worse." The filming then shifts to a warehouse where Carl is chastising a hapless bureaucrat while the voiceover makes the case for a senator who's relentless in fighting against waste in government. Now, fast forward. It's the summer of 2000, and Carl is hustling across the Capitol grounds. Did Carl ever do anything except hustle? I mean, he was never, you know, there's not a slow moment that I can recall. Hustling across the Capitol grounds on a sunny day, a group of UAW retirees who are touring the area spy Carl at a distance. One of them yells,
hey, Carl, was that really your garage?
Without hesitating, Carl shouts back,
hell no, it wasn't even my shirt.
The second story, strangely enough, also features a garage. This one in the neighborhood where I grew up in Macomb County. It's the fall of 1993, not long after I went to work for Carl as his state director. In order to get a feel for how people felt about my new boss, I decided to talk to voters door to door. This was during the rocky first year of the Clinton administration. So I began by asking those who'd talk with me how they felt about President Clinton. No matter what ensued at that point, I'd bring the conversation around to Carl. How do you think Senator Levin's doing? At one door, the lady of the house declined to talk with me, but said she thought her husband would. And boy, was she ever right. I found him out back in the garage, ready to get into it. Almost 30 years later, I can remember this conversation verbatim, but I'm going to soften the language in one spot. Here's how it went after I introduced myself. How do you think President Clinton's doing? You want to know how I think President Clinton's doing? I'll tell you how I think President Clinton's doing. Well, I don't like having some ACLU witch on the Supreme Court. I don't like having all this talk about homosexuals in the military, and I don't like having women and minorities all through the government. That's how I think President Clinton's doing. How do you think Senator Levin's doing? Carl Levin? Carl Levin. Carl Levin is a good senator. He's a moral senator. You know, he worked in an auto plant, and I don't care if it was for 2 weeks. It's better than the rest of these sons of bitches. Now, if this gentleman and Warren's politics seem a bit out of kilter to you, that's understandable. He wouldn't have seen eye to eye with Carl on any of those three complaints of his. But this man knew something more important. He knew something real. He knew something true. With all the noise and negativism of our politics, he'd figured out that Carl Levin genuinely cared about people like him. And in this incredibly difficult political environment we're all struggling with today, that is something I hope I always remember about Carl Levin. Thank you.
The ring, that's a telephone. I would simply say, Carl Levin's office. And that's how some people will recognize me. My highest regard today to the Levin family, to Barbara, Kate, Laura, Erica, Sandy, Representative Levin. Our hearts are with you. I know what it is to lose a father. And the life has it like that, that we're supposed to bury our parents. And it's a blessing that our parents don't have to always bury us. I had the chance of working with Carl Levin now for 36 years. I'm proud in that 36 years, I am one of the longest serving Black representatives that worked for a senator from the state of Michigan. I'm so proud of that. Today, I just want to stand and just talk about a man of compassion, and a man whose integrity could never be questioned. But before I go on there, I gotta thank my political mentor, who recognized and horned in on my talents in Carl Levin's office. It was through him that I learned this password. And some of you might remember this, 2641 K. 1:35. And then we had to type at the end of it, was Fred. That was my Senate password to get online. And we, you guys got to remember that. That was just so wonderful. Thank you, Rick Weiner. Richard Weiner opened up so much for me, politically astute, allowed me to horn in my gifts in office administration and learning how to operate an office. And the layout in Carl Levin's office was because Rick Weiner saw something in me. Get us, we need telephone lines, we need computer lines, we need electrical lines, set up the desk. And I'm 20 years old. But Rick Weiner saw something in me. Thank you so much. I speak at church and I minister at church. But this is a hard aggregation to try to speak today. I often rely on the word, Lord, give me something to say to your people. But today, I'm humbled because I get a chance to speak before some scholars, some speech writers, some profound authors. And it's great. So I may not be as articulate as some of you were doing your writings, but I'm humbled even more. There were many opportunities that I drove Senator Levin around and talking about some of those speeches. I had to drive him to Lansing to meet with Jim Turner or going towards Saginaw. And in some of those, Carl Levin would get the speech. Did you get my speech? Yes, I got your speech. And he would sit and try to navigate me going down I-75 or 696. And still manage to make some correction to those speeches. I do recall a few times, and God bless her heart, Jackie Parker would call and say, Carl, you get the speech? Yes, I got the speech, Jackie. Did Carl? Yes, Carl. Did you take it? Take one with you? Did he deliver it word from word? Yeah, Jackie, he did a great job. I didn't want to hurt her feelings and say he did a lot of scratch outs. He did a lot of deletions. But that was a Carl Levin. So I just decided to speak on a few points here, and I won't be before you long. One time I was told to staff Carl at the annual NAACP dinner down at Cobo Hall, now we call it TCF. It was in the early 80s. Carl had given me the sign, George, when I'm ready to go, you know, I'll give you this clue. And I knew that that was the time for me to go meet him at the end of the dais. As we departed Cobo Hall, we got in the hallway, and when we were walking down the corridor, a strange man came up. Senator Carl Levin, I want to shake your hand. Carl. I never had the chance to say thank you, sir. Carl looked again in awe. He said, you represented me in the mid-60s when you was in the public defender's office. You won my case. I was in the bullpen and I could not shake my attorney's hand. Carl got teary-eyed. He said, this was the opportunity for me to say thank you and I want to shake your hand. I looked in awesome wonder myself, and Carl was, thank you so much. That was so gratifying him. That's that compassion that he had. Another time, I was Carl's academy coordinator and worked with the PAGE program in Michigan. We had a student who had a little crush on one of the other pages and wrote a note to the young lady. The young lady did not like it. And the principal at the PAGE school gave me a call. We got a problem here. How should we handle this? And Carl had got whipped of it, and he was in the office. He says, yo, George, you want me to make a phone call? I said, no. I said, Carl, I don't think it'd be necessary. He wrote something to this young lady, and she took offense to it. I said, it's best that we bring him home. I said, Richard Carter. I called Rich Carter, and he went over to the PAGE school and got the young man, and they discharged him immediately. But that compassion kicked in. Carl wanted to make sure that this young man had due process, but it really wasn't necessary. On times, he would call the office, and I was happy about this one because people say, Carl, don't say thank you a whole lot. But on this one occasion, Carl called and I said, Carl Levin's office. Oh, wait, George, don't transfer me. He said, I'm at the airport. Two Jewish ladies headed up to, they were going to Israel, and they walked up to me, gave me a big hug and a kiss. He said, George, I don't know what you did to help get their passports, but thank you. So I want to say, I do not know everybody here. If either one of those two ladies are still here, you owe me a hug because Carl Levin got it. And my last one, in closing, I know that we've all had some outstanding moments that we will cherish that we had with Carl Levin, and it forever be embedded in our heart. But we were fortunate to serve Carl Levin. However, we were blessed to serve a man who was a man before he was a politician. Carl would often go into his pocket. This cookie's for you, Carl. We remember you. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Tara Andringa, and I worked for Carl for 21 years. For the great majority of that time, I was his communications director and press secretary. First, I just wanted to say I was supposed to share the podium with Allison Warner, who was another long-term staff member of Carl's, and she works for the Senate Armed Services Committee now, and is spending the weekend sorting through 433 amendments to the Defense Authorization Bill, getting ready for markup this weekend. And she was heartbroken that she couldn't be here, but I said, honestly, Allison, what better way could you honor Carl Levin than sorting through 433 defense authorization amendments? So we are talking a lot today about how Carl was a towering legislator and he was an icon of integrity, but I also just wanted to talk about how he was such an amazing boss. The most shorthanded way to say that is I worked for him for 21 years, and I wasn't even in the top five of Levin staff longevity. You just never wanted to leave. And he was just great work to work for, and that manifested itself in a lot of different ways. Probably the clearest was just his unquenchable intellectual curiosity. He always wanted to know more and ask questions and dig deeper. And staff, the way that our scheduling process worked is each night he would take his schedule home for the next day. And for each item on the schedule, he would have a memo for the next morning. And you'd write the memo, and he would take it home and read it carefully, and half of it would be underlined in his felt-tip pen. And this seems like it would be scientifically impossible, but you would write the memo, and then the next day he would bring it back, and he would know it better than you. And so you'd then go into his office, and he would be sitting on his velvet couch with, you know, papers around him, and you'd sit in the chair next to him, and he would start the questions. You know, what about this? And could we find more about this? And what's the background on this? And your first lesson as a Levin staffer was you don't bluff. You answer the questions, and you answer until he asked a question that you didn't know, and then you'd say, Carl, I don't know the answer. I will find it, and I'll get back to you. And it sometimes felt like to Carl that was like part of this game of like Senate staff mercy. Like he was determined to find the point that you were like, Carl, the well is dry. I've got nothing. But he made you bring your A game, and he made us all better human beings. Now, I don't want to suggest that life in the office was all academic rigor, because another remarkable thing about Carl was his ability to find joy in everything. And he was just funny. And I have this memory of once he had a TV interview. And so we were walking over, there was this recording studio in the Senate Hart building, like on the fourth or fifth floor. And I was wearing heels and a business suit with, you know, a skirt, and I had my, you know, quintessential Senate staff accessory of the stack of briefing materials. And we're walking over, and we get to the bottom stair, and we're gonna walk up the four flights of stairs. And Carl turns his head, looks over his shoulder, and looks at me and says, "Wanna race?" Now, clearly there is one answer, which is, Heck yeah. So we start sprinting up the stairs, just like, you know, going 100 miles an hour round and round and round the staircase. Now, he was 35 years my senior, and we finished neck and neck, and, you know, I'm a mess. Like, I have papers flying everywhere. I'm out of breath. Carl just, like, you know, straightens his tie, goes in, sits in the you know, puts the mic on his lapel, and he's good to go. His zeal for living was infectious. He just found joy in everything he did. And then the last thing I just wanted to comment on was his incredible compassion. When I worked for him, I had a couple losses and lost my father-in-law suddenly and unexpectedly. And I remember I got back to the office and everyone was so kind and, you know, said, thinking about you and what can I do? And I went into Carl's office and Carl said, tell me about him. And I started ticking off the, you know, bullet points of my father-in-law's life. And Carl said, how many grandkids did he have? And it just struck me, his deep care and love for people. He was just curious about people and had this deep humanness that really impacted everything he did and the way he approached his job and living and staff. And he just cared so much about everybody. And it was the greatest honor of my life to work for a giant of a legislator and just a giant of a human being. Thank you so much.
Barbara and all the Levin family, everyone in this room hoped and prayed this day would never come. All of us who worked with Carl share in your loss, and it was the country's loss as well. My name is David Lyles. I was Carl's chief of staff for 12 years, his staff director on the Armed Services Committee for 4 years, and his second string squash partner beginning in the early 1980s. My squash games with Carl never came close to Carl and Sandy's legendary rivalry. But I always knew when Carl was going to call and want to play squash, when Sandy was out of town, or if I'd beaten him the day before. Ben, he did have a corner shot that was a lot like that drop shot. This afternoon, I want to try to give you a sense of what it was like to work with Carl. Organizations draw strength and inspiration from their leader, and that was certainly true of Carl's Senate office. Carl Levin loved his work. And those of us who had the privilege of working with Carl can tell you that one of the hallmarks of the staff was that people really loved working for Carl. You could see it in their faces, and you could feel it in the enthusiasm they brought to the office every day. It's easy to explain why people wanted to come to work for Carl and never wanted to leave. Carl challenged all of us in the same way he challenged himself, to do the very best work we were capable of for the people of Michigan and for our whole country. For everyone in this room this afternoon, politician is not a derogatory term. It's a mark of distinction because Carl Levin made the term synonymous with honor and integrity and compassion and respect for others. When Carl asked me in 2001 to leave the Armed Services Committee staff and become his chief of staff, I did so with a little trepidation. I wasn't sure how Carl's constituents would take to someone who thought the bridge was called Mackinac, and who definitely didn't sound like they came from Michigan. My trepidation was short-lived, though, because I quickly learned that all I had to do was tell someone from Michigan I worked for Carl Levin, and they immediately assumed I was okay. I want to close with just a few anecdotes, like those that Chuck shared with you. One night in the late 1980s, when the annual defense bill was on the Senate floor, committee members got tangled up in a debate that was going nowhere. So Senator Goldwater, who was presiding at the time, invited all of us to his president pro tempore office. When we got there, Senator Thurman welcomed everyone to his office. Then he went around the room, giving each person a Strom Thurmond keychain to commemorate the evening. When Senator Thurman got to Carl, Carl said, "Strom, I already have one. Can I have a car instead?" Twenty years or so later, we were sitting in the Armed Services Committee hearing room. Senator Thurmond had stepped down as chairman of the committee, and Senator Warner had taken over as chairman. Senator Thurmond was sitting on Senator Warner's right, and Carl, as the senior Democrat, was sitting on Senator Warner's left. Senator Warner got up and left the hearing for a few minutes, and Senator Thurmond looked to his left and saw Carl rather than Senator Warner. He leaned over and whispered, "Carl, I miss working with you." Carl didn't say anything. He just held his hand out behind Senator Warner's chair, and two senators who had little in common beyond their love of country and their reverence for the United States Senate just held hands for a minute or two. After it was over, I referred to it as the Codel from Hell. 3 nights and 2 days in Kosovo in the late 1990s. A week or so after the Serbs had been expelled, we got to spend half of one of those nights in a bed. In other words, it was a typical Carl Levin Codel. On the overnight flight back to Washington after the Air Force steward served dinner, he asked me if I thought the senators would like to watch a movie. Barbara, I said yes, but I swear I had no idea what movie he was going to put on. 10 minutes into A Fish Called Wanda, everyone on the small Gulfstream plane was roaring with laughter. Everyone, that is, except Carl. Right after dinner, he started writing up his notes from the trip with his usual focus and intensity. I don't think he ever even looked up at the movie screen. In his farewell address to the Senate in December of 2014, Carl thanked all of his current and former staff for believing in public service. Barbara, Erica, Laura, Kate, all the grandchildren, Sandy, it is all of us here this afternoon who will be forever grateful to your husband, your father, your grandfather, your brother, for the privilege of learning from and working with one of the great legislators and great investigators and one of the truly great and decent and honorable public servants of our generation. Thank you.
I'm Linda Gastitis.
And I'm Elise Bean. Linda and I had the great pleasure of working together for Carl.
Me for 24 years.
Me for 29 years.
So we thought, even despite all the wonderful things that have been said, and some of this will be repetitious, but we thought we'd share with you the highlights of what it was like to work for such a truly wonderful human being.
If we were to make a word cloud for Carl, those words would be
smart, super smart.
Energy, endless energy.
Compassion.
Honesty.
Empathy.
Bipartisan.
Funny.
And fun.
Curious.
Factual.
Fair.
Committed to justice.
Down to earth.
White shirts.
Rolled sleeves.
Cowboy cap. His cowboy hat.
Comb over,
right. Cookies.
And tea.
Squash with Sandy.
Opera.
Collecting stamps.
Collecting autographs.
A true public servant.
A teacher.
A mentor.
Friend.
A friend.
Our subcommittee offices were in the basement of the Senate Russell Building.
Carl's office was on the second floor.
So here's a typical moment from our work week.
Linda and I would be discussing an upcoming hearing.
The phone would ring.
In the early years, it was Helen.
Or later on, it was Molly or Allison.
Whoever it was would say, "Carl wants to see you."
And often added, "He's about to leave for the Senate floor."
We knew what that meant.
We'd drop everything we had in front of us, and we'd go as fast as we could up to his office.
I took the elevator.
No. Yes. Hating elevators, I took the stairs.
We'd dash into Carl's office.
He'd be unrolling the sleeves of his shirt and putting on his suit jacket and stuffing the scraps of paper into his shirt pocket.
He'd say, "Walk with me."
We knew what that meant. Run.
Carl would shout to Helen or Molly or Allison,
"I'm going to the floor."
9 times out of 10, she would jump up, hand him something.
As he took off out the door.
Jogging behind. Trying to keep up, we'd fill him in on the latest complex tax shelter or money laundering scheme.
Racing down the halls, Carl would ask us tough and detailed questions as we went, sometimes starting down the stairs or sometimes impatiently pushing the button for the elevator.
in the basement. We'd follow him to the subway train that went to the Senate floor and hope he'd let us go.
If we were lucky, he'd meet another senator who would want a word with him.
Relieved, we would head back to our office, a little out of breath.
We hated it.
We loved it.
We loved it. It was a pleasure and a treasure to work for someone who wanted to be sure he knew what he needed to know.
And who was willing to put in the work and the time to get there.
He always wanted to know more.
So he could do more.
He was unique.
One of a kind.
Confession, we loved him.
Confession, it was the best years of our professional life.
So everyone here had their own relationship with Carl. We all remember moments, funny, intense, poignant, that revealed Carl's big heart, his intellect, and his integrity. It's hard to accept that he's gone, that all of us and the country have lost his wise counsel, his warmth, and his leadership.
But what is uplifting is knowing that all of us can honor his legacy, his passion for the facts, to know what really happened and what the real problems are, so we can move forward, fix them, and do better. Tolerance, compassion, respect for each other.
It's good to be together today.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Kathy Gray, and I think I've interviewed many of you here during 3 or 4 decades of political reporting in Michigan. It's always been an honor and a privilege to do that reporting about Senator Levin and many others and tell the stories of triumph and defeat, public policy journeys, and pure partisan politics. But I'd like for you to for a moment, imagine being in a newsroom back in the day before Zoom reporting put a damper on the controlled chaos that reporters and editors live and thrive in every day. At 4 p.m., as 4 p.m. approached, the deadline frenzy began. I usually put on headphones to block out the noise and mayhem until an editor would call out and say, drop everything. That would only happen for a few select people who would drop in unannounced for a chat with the editorial board and reporters. For most unexpected guests, such a late in the day, bust the deadline visit would be quickly rebuffed. But not for Senator Carl Levin, who we affectionately called either the professor or Uncle Carl. That whip-smart, unassuming politician who we would all happily welcome for the lessons we were about to learn. He came armed with briefing books, sleeves rolled up, ready to talk about his latest passion, whether it was visit to the front lines in Afghanistan, the skewering of defense contractors, or even his investigation into shady offshore accounts. He lit up when he shared these experiences, knowing that it was his duty to lead and inform. He was never indifferent and could make any subject, no matter how dry or arcane, worthy of a front page story or a fiery op-ed. Now, most politicians have a shtick that reporters instantly recognized, a political persona that they adopt when they're out in public but abandon when the cameras are off. For some, the rolled up sleeves, glad handing, or the sly wink are a well-practiced act, but not Senator Levin. The rumpled suit, the steely gaze over his half glasses were exactly who he was. He looked the same whether it was 8 a.m. or 8 p.m. or at 4 p.m. on deadline. It's not easy to say about most politicians, especially these days, but Senator Levin was absolutely genuine, and he never lost his passion for pursuing the next right thing to do. I read every obituary, sadly, written about Senator Levin, and a passage in the New York Times really stood out for me. With his longish silver hair, affable smile, and glasses perched low on the nose, He looked more like a kindly old world shoemaker than the terror of the Senate. But he confronted the titans of JPMorgan Chase, Apple, American Express, and other corporate giants like a barbarian at the gate. In addition to being kind, Senator Levin was incredibly gracious and patient. As a reporter at Papers Across his beloved state of Michigan, I had the opportunity to ask him a lot of questions over the years. Some of them were ill-informed or repetitive or even stupid. But even though he was without question the smartest person in the room, he never once rolled his eyes or scoffed at such inquiries. He patiently answered each and every one of those questions, and it didn't matter if I was working for the Gratiot County Herald or the Detroit Free Press. I can't say that about many of the hundreds of politicians I've covered over the years. So it stings when we've lost one of the best. To his friends and family, thank you for sharing such a giant with us for so many years. And to you, Senator Levin, thank you for being both the kindly professor and the barbarian at the gate.
I don't know of anyone in this body who has exhibited more of an intellectual honesty, a calm demeanor, a sense of fierce loyalty, and perseverance. I don't know anyone who exhibits those qualities more than Carl Levin. Carl embodies the best of what I think it means to be both a citizen and a United States Senator. Barbara and Carl and Ruth and I have enjoyed many meals together over the years, great conversations about everything. And I just want to say to my friend Carl, I hope that Michigan and Iowa are not so far apart that we can't continue to get together in the future. And I will say, Carl, right now, I hope that you don't hold it against me for all of the times that the Hawkeyes will beat the Wolverines in the future. Don't let that be a stumbling block to our friendship.
I have been blessed to have a front row seat to watch Carl Levin work. From a seat on the Armed Services Committee and a seat on the Permanent Subcommittee on Investigations, I have watched his excellent staff, but I have watched Carl Levin. This is a man who understands every nook and cranny of statutory construction. I will think of Carl Levin fondly one way. His shoulders slightly stooped, his hand grasping a piece of paper, not an electronic device, him walking quickly towards me with his head down, peering over the ubiquitous glasses, saying, Claire, have you read the language? Claire, have you read the language? He has the tools of a great senator. Intellect, integrity, good manners, and an unsurpassed work ethic. I will always call him my most important mentor in the Senate. He has taught me more than I can ever say. And I will try desperately to live up to the ideal he has set for all of us.
Mr. President, I want to offer a few words of tribute to my departing colleague, Senator Carl Levin, model of serious purpose, firm principle, and personal decency, and whose example ought to inspire the service of new and returning senators. We could not aspire to better service than what he has given our country. Carl and I have served together on the Senate Armed Services Committee for the better part of three decades. It's been a privilege to serve under his very able, honorable, and fair leadership. Carl and I sit on opposite sides of the aisle. The difference is quite obvious on any number of issues. But I hope it's also obvious how much I admire and respect my friend from Michigan. While Carl Levin and I may have had our disagreements, we never let them get in the way of finding common ground where we could. His patience, thoughtfulness, and commitment to bipartisanship will be deeply missed on the subcommittee and in the Senate. Of course, the greatest compliment one senator can pay another is to credit him or her as a person who keeps his or her word. That's become too rare in Washington, but not so in my experiences with Carl Levin. He has never broken his word to me. He has never backed out of a deal, even when doing so would have been personally and politically advantageous. One of the great satisfactions in life is to fight for a common cause with someone you haven't always agreed with, someone whose background, views, and personality are different from yours. And yet you discover that despite your differences, you have always been on the same side on the big things. Thank you, Carl, for the privilege and for your friendship and example. The committee is going to miss you. The Senate is going to miss you. The men and women of the United States Armed Forces are going to miss you. And I will miss you a lot.
Good afternoon. I'm Carl's nephew, Andy Levin, and I'm kicking off the third of our three groups, the elected officials. And each of these very important people are going to remember to introduce themselves because people are watching on YouTube or somewhere, and we don't have captions. But before I share some of my own remarks, I want to ask the colleagues of Carl Levin, who may be here from the Common Council, as it was called. Some of you remember before it was called the City Council, from the House, from the Senate. Would you all please stand and be recognized because there's quite a number of you here. Governor Blanchard, that includes you. Thank you. For six decades, my Uncle Carl was a quiet but emphatic presence in my life, from my earliest memory until his last breath. Perhaps above all, he defined with my dad how close two siblings can be. They never merged their identities, no matter how often and humorously they were confused for each other, but they embarked on all manner of adventure, drove cabs, and yes, worked at auto plants in Detroit, shared a room from kindergarten to law school, were the key advisor on every single campaign from Common Council to State Senate to Congress, had each other's back always, talked almost daily and sometimes hourly, deferred in each other's areas of expertise, and bragged on their brother's leadership. In the end, these two Jewish boys from Detroit, these grandsons of immigrants, each served 36 years in Congress, 32 of them together, becoming by far the longest co-serving siblings in the Congress's 233-year history. As you've heard, they competed fiercely in innumerable squash matches and one-on-one basketball games, each always insisting he alone was at fault for any collision or foul. And as someone who got to play in some of those games, it got to the point of like, could we just keep playing already? This paradigmatic brotherhood arose from and symbolized a larger sense that everything started with family. Indeed, in my childhood, we had extended family dinners every Sunday night, rotating between our house, Carl and Barbara's house, our late Aunt Hannah and Uncle Bill's house, and my Grandma Bess's apartment. The gatherings were equally full of recipes and cooking, play and sports and silliness, and of course, endless politics, planning, strategizing, and debating the issues of the day. Carl personified integrity and the notion of putting the public good above self-interest. As he walked about the Capitol in a rumpled suit, almost always with a white shirt and plain tie, Carrying bulging files with the occasional paper flying away, Carl was the very picture of sober purpose and rectitude. But he was also very funny. He often pierced tense situations with self-deprecating humor, and he shared penetrating observations about other people with staff and colleagues in private. I can't tell you how many times I got to participate in a conversation between Uncle Carl and some very important person. And as we walked away afterwards, he cut to the quick about what was behind their posturing or pontificating. Being taken into Uncle Carl's confidence in this way was something special in the life of many of his staff and friends. But Carl was all about the work and the great honor the people of Michigan had bestowed upon him with their votes and their trust. He did not seek to divine their views and be popular, but rather to study the issues and advance the people's interests to the best of his ability. Uncle Carl met with more kings and queens and presidents and other important people than all but a few of us ever will. But he treated them all the same as the humblest Detroit auto worker or farmer, beet farmer, say, from Michigan's thumb. And yes, he knew every product that Michiganders raised and where we ranked in the nation, whether it was black beans or raspberries or blueberries or whatever. He treated everybody with a full measure of dignity, but no airs, ever ready to puncture self-importance, posturing, mendacity, and avarice. I think it's fitting that we're remembering Uncle Carl's life as the House Select Committee to investigate the January 6th attack on the Capitol has finally begun its public hearings. Carl so loved this country. He was a student of American history. He collected everything, stamps, coins, memorabilia. Among his favorite items was a framed original copy of the Chicago Tribune with a headline plastered across the front page, "Dewey Defeats Truman." He understood how fragile our democracy is and that its very survival was hanging in the balance when he passed away. Ever the champion of bipartisanship, he would have been so proud of the performance of our fierce ideological foe, Liz Cheney. Country before party. As we face the pileup of problems bedeviling our nation, from authoritarianism to the overheating of our planet, to surging white supremacy, to the epidemic of gun violence and more, it's calming to me at least that we can stand on Uncle Carl's shoulders. If we deeply respect other people, if we act with integrity, if we always seek the truth, we will find a way forward together. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. My name is Jennifer Granholm. I first met the spirit of Carl Levin through Barbara Levin. And Barbara remembers this, too. I know I was a young pup working at the Democratic Party for the Dukakis campaign. And I was the deputy constituencies director, and Barbara was there working on women's issues. And I staffed her on a bus tour around Michigan, Women for Levin. And I was so in awe of your fierce feminism, your brains, your strategy, and your kindness. And I thought, man, if she would marry Carl Levin, he must not be all bad. And so, of course, he was so much more than that. I was talking about Carl with some staffers from Congress who happen to be on my staff now. And they were, I'm so glad the way this has been structured so that your memories are front and center, because he put you all front and center. And that's why my staff, who never worked for Carl Levin, but knew of everybody who had, and said, man, those people were so lucky to work for that man. And of course, in Michigan, we all know Carl as this icon of integrity. And I remember I once asked him if he was ever going to get an electric vehicle. Now, this was before charging stations and all of that. And he said that he would once the lawyers figured out how to apportion the cost of charging electricity in the Senate parking lot because he had to pay his fair share. That was him. Integrity in things, large and small. And of course, in that vein, he was a mentor to me and to so many others. And I know I sought his advice on a lot of things. And I remember clearly that he told me there's two things that stand out. One is that the secret to success as a politician is making sure that you don't do anything that you wouldn't want to see on the front page of the Detroit Free Press or the Detroit News. And the second, I remember, when I was governor, Michigan was on its knees because it was during the Great Recession and the auto industry was in bankruptcy. And I remember he and I were sitting at an event and we were waiting for something to start and he was saying, well, how are things going? And I was, oh my God, it's just so hard, blah, 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 blah. And he listens to me drone on. And then he leaned in and he gently, with a twinkle in his eye that you all know, said, maybe you should consider getting a really better sense of humor. He said, people appreciate politicians who can laugh at themselves. A joke or two. Of course, he was really such a natural, as has been described. I know my favorite story about him, which I know I've heard and many of you've heard him talk about, is that, you know, whoever he was running against, some slick, you know, whether it was astronaut Lousmo or any of the other slick people that he might have been running against, he knew he was going to win because his pollsters would tell him that if he starts his campaign literature with his description of being, 5'9", plump, balding, disheveled, that he knew he would win because, of course, there are more people like him than whoever his opponent was. And we all did love that frumpiness. It wasn't just that he rolled up his sleeves. It was that they were like in wrinkled sausages at right here. And he signaled by that frumpiness that he was going to focus on things that were more important than appearance. He was going to fight battles for everyday people. He was a lion for the little guy. He and Sandy jointly, I think you still have this in the family, the lion's den, right? This retreat, this cottage that they would go to regroup from the acrimony of Washington. So my husband Dan ran Sandy's congressional campaign in 1992. This was just after redistricting. It was a hard battle. When the battle was over, Sandy invited our family to visit the Levin brothers and Barbara and Vicky at the Lion's Den. And I thought, what a great thing. This sort of rustic then, maybe it's unfussy, right? Beautiful retreat where the lions would go to heal after battling for all of us. So these Levins, these lions fighting for us all through the generations. And now Carl is in his lion's den, but he's infused in all of us that responsibility to fight for a better world. Nancy Pelosi, some of you may have heard her speak about having visited a bishop in South Africa, and on the wall of the bishop's office was this prayer. And the prayer says, when at last I stand before the face of God, God will say to me, show me your wounds. And if I have no wounds, God will ask, was there nothing worth fighting for? At the end of the day, Carl Levin proudly bore the wounds and the scars from fighting for us for all those decades. May we all be so scarred. May we all carry his example from Sandy and Barbara and Andy and Laura and Kate and Erica and the entire Levin family. May we all be so scarred to be able to fight in our own ways the battles worth waging. That is a legacy.
Well, good afternoon. I'm Debbie Stabenow, and I had the honor of being the junior senator from Michigan to the senior senator, Carl Levin. What an incredible honor that was. Let me first start, Barbara. Love you and Kate and Laura and Erica and Sandy and Andy and everyone in the Levin family. I know that this will go on to be a continual loss for all of you, but there is so much to celebrate about this wonderful man and all that he has left for all of us, really. For everyone that is here that is joining us, we're so glad you're here today, and I want to thank my colleagues, Jack Reed, who is here, who you've seen in many of the pictures that have been put up, all the trips with the Armed Services Committee, and Tom Carper and Martha Carper, thank you for being here. And Heidi Heitkamp, I know Heidi is here as well. Thank you, Heidi, and others for being here as well. I feel like just standing up and saying amen to everything that's already been said. It's such an honor to be here to really celebrate somebody who just showed us what public service was about. You want to talk about public service, you want to talk about what is best about being a politician or being public service, you just have to say Carl Levin. But before he was my colleague, I have to say he was already an icon for me. He was my senator. And I couldn't believe it when I got elected in 2000 and could actually be his partner in the United States Senate after having held him in such high esteem for so long. It was really an honor for me to be his partner for 14 years of his 36 years. And he was a role model on issue after issue. He did do his homework. In fact, it's been said that Carl would know more about what corporate execs were going to say when they testified in his committee than they knew. He was prepared. He was tough on the bad guys, that's for sure. But he was kind and generous and thoughtful with everybody else. I have to say, on issue after issue, when it was tough, when we were trying to figure out what to do, I would over and over again look at Carl, listen to Carl, sit with Carl in meetings, and walk through, because I knew that he would be so prepared. You know, Carl loved community events as well. There was a picture up here of Sandy and Carl at a parade. One of my images of Carl is Carl and Sandy walking down a parade route. And I would usually be in the car right behind them, watching them run from side to side, shaking hands. And once in a while, Carl would get stopped and he'd get way behind. We were going forward on the cars, and then he would run up and get involved again. But there was such energy and joy in all of these parades and community events. And I have to also tell you that Carl never went hungry, because it wasn't just the cookies. Every single reception he went to, if you watch closely, there were hors d'oeuvres wrapped in napkins that stuck in his pocket, right? Or in the breast pocket or something. Now, and that wasn't just Carl. That's a Levin tradition. Never leave hungry. Always be prepared. You never know. It might be a while before you get to eat again. I also want to share some of my early images. You know, I came in as icon Carl Levin. I'm so excited to be with him. And then we would go to Senate Democratic retreats. I remember the Senate Democratic retreats. And first of all, Barbara and I were part of a singing group that Barbara Boxer put together called The Dems. And she would do these wonderful parodies of whatever the current events were. And we would get up and sing. But the image in my mind, always in those early years, in fact, the first time around, I couldn't believe it. Ted Kennedy and Chuck Schumer doing karaoke. Do you remember this? Did Ted? And Carl Levin and Barbara, but it was mainly Carl Levin, dancing on the floor. He was on the floor dancing, but you really can't describe it as dancing. It was hopping. And I'm not kidding. He hopped, right? And Barbara was so patient and giving. She would dance right along with the same images. And we would try to dance, but we would be laughing so hard that we could barely dance. He loved it. He loved it. The music, the joy, the hopping, the dancing. And he would go on and on and on. As has been said, he brought so much passion and so much joy to every single thing that he did. And he loved Michigan. He loved Detroit. He loved every part of our state, from Thunder Bay to Keweenaw National Historic Park to Sleeping Bear Dunes to the Riverwalk in his beloved Detroit. He loved Michigan. He loved Detroit. He wanted to make sure that our state and our country could be the best it could be and that everybody in it had a chance to be the best that they could be. And he spent his entire life working hard to make that happen. Most importantly to me is he was a dear friend. And I will always miss him. May Carl's memory forever be a blessing to everyone he touched, everyone who knew him. He certainly has been a blessing to me.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for an opportunity to say a few words about our dear friend and the lion in the Senate, Carl Levin. No words can ever begin to describe the incredible legacy that Carl left in our state, our nation, and the world. He was a strong, progressive voice for working families, but he never was afraid to reach across the aisle to get things done. Today's Senate would do well to learn from his leadership and uphold his no-nonsense approach. I would not be here today in the United States Senate without Carl's leadership and without his mentorship. When I was first elected to the House of Representatives, I sought his guidance on navigating Capitol Hill, forging relationships with other members, and fighting for Michigan. It's why I keep a map of Michigan that Carl gave me, along with his very thoughtful handwritten note that accompanied that map, framed in my front office. I am always reminded of him and strive to approach my work based on the example that he set. Through his chairmanship of PSI, Carl stood up for millions of people who were taken advantage of while corporations made major profits at their expense. He always did his homework, and he held the bad guys accountable. Through his chairmanship on the Senate Armed Services Committee, he worked to strengthen our national security and keep us all safe. Carl led our delegation with fierce determination and resolve through thick and thin. Whether it was protecting the Great Lakes, the auto rescue, or being forward-thinking when it came to new vehicle technologies and transit. Despite these high-profile roles in Washington, Carl never forgot his roots. To this day, everywhere I go in Michigan, folks tell me how much they loved and respected Carl. Even if they disagreed with him, they always admired his integrity, his grit, and his devotion to our state. He truly was the epitome of what it means to be a public servant. To Barbara, Kate, Laura, Erica, Sandy, the entire Levin family, and everyone who had the honor of knowing him, Carl will forever live in our hearts.
Sandy, I'm sorry I can't be with you today to express my regards, my love for your brother Carl, but I am glad that you asked me to say a few words about my relationship with him. The people of Michigan elected Carl Levin in 1978 to the United States Senate. The people of Maine did the same for me. We had not known each other prior to that time, but immediately we became fast friends. And for the next 18 years, we served on the Senate Armed Services Committee together, the Government Affairs Committee, and the Subcommittee on Oversight. Together, we traveled the world. I asked Carl to travel with me on many missions to the Middle East and beyond, to Russia and elsewhere. And we did so in order to make sure that our men and women who were serving us were well-trained, well-equipped, and well-prepared to carry out the missions, as well as their families well cared for. When we went to the Government Affairs Committee, we conducted investigations to make sure that the taxpayers' dollars were being well spent. And we worked on issues from Social Security disability, reforming the Lobby Disclosure Act, rooting out fraud, waste, and abuse, and so many other issues. But always, Carl was vigorous in the pursuit of the truth. And I don't know of a person I served with who was a better and more honorable public servant than Carl. He was also a great human being. And his passing struck me in a way that some of the others did, but it was more personal with Carl. We lost Colin Powell, we lost Madeleine Albright, we lost Walter Mondale, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, Justice Ginsburg, John Lewis, John McCain, and so many others who all had the same characteristic that Carl did. Honor, being honorable, being honest, and being humble. And so I got to serve those 18 years with Carl in the Senate, but then I had four more years I was serving at the Defense Department, and I had to testify before the Senate Armed Services Committee. And Carl was just as tough on me as he'd been on any Secretary of Defense in the past. And that is how it should have been and how it was, because Carl was after always the truth, not favor or fear, just after the truth. And so I'm sad on this day. It's one to commemorate Carl's memory, but also to celebrate it. And I'm just delighted that we now have the Carl Levin Center, so that people who didn't have the chance to meet Carl can look at the legacy that he's left. What a great honor. So I'm proud to have associated, to have known Carl, and to have been his friend. Thank you. Sandy.
I'm Senator Jack Reed, and I'm honored and privileged to join you to recognize and honor my friend, my dear, dear friend, Carl Levin. I'm pleased also and privileged to be with my colleagues from the Senate, Debbie Stabenow and Tom Carper and Heidi Hancock, and also our colleague from the House, Debbie Dingell, and Secretary Granholm, Governor Blanchett, Secretary Brunson. Thank you. But I really want to begin by recognizing Carl's family, his beloved wife, Barbara, their wonderful daughters and grandchildren, his brother, Sandy, his nephew, Andy, because we all know that all those public accomplishments that Carl had were transcended by the fact that he was above all else, a loving father, a devoted husband, and a profoundly compassionate man. And we thank you for letting share him with us. Now, from his earliest days growing up in Detroit, Carl understood what service and hard work meant. He worked his way up as an auto worker. He drove a taxi. His brilliance and his hard work got him through a law school, a pretty good law school, I heard, too. Then he came back, but he didn't come back to make a lot of money in a big firm in New York or Washington, D.C., elsewhere. He came back to work for the Michigan Civil Rights Commission as a public defender so he could help people who, without his assistance, would be lost, in fact, deliberately, in some cases, lost in the system. And then he was on the Common Council for many years, always trying to advance opportunity and justice for everyone, not just the entitled elites. And then 3.5 decades in the United States Senate, a profound contribution to this nation that will live on forever as a monument to Carl and as a benefit to us all. Carl really changed how our government worked. He used his legislative powers, his backbone, and his brains to take on the most powerful institutions in America. And it was not just on behalf of the little guy, it was to build and sustain a healthier republic, a democracy where the people's voice and vote counts. And boy, do we need him today. But his spirit inspires us to do that work. Now, I served alongside Carl on the Armed Services Committee, and frankly, it was one of the greatest privileges of my life. He was my mentor. He was the person I said, man, if I could ever be half as good as Carl Levin, I'll be pretty good. Now, we were such close friends, we used to joke that the reason we were so close friends is I made Carl look tall, and he made me feel like the most elegant dresser in the United States Senate. As it's been suggested several times this afternoon, sartorial splendor and Carl Levin never intersected. But when he took on his duties on the Armed Services Committee, he understood that national security is not just military power. It is the marshaling of our diplomatic power, our moral authority, our economic power. And he strove to integrate all of those factors together to build a stronger America, and he succeeded spectacularly. But one of the things I think that most profoundly influenced Carl as chairman of the committee is that he recognized that the dedication and sacrifice of our service members and their families is fundamental to our success. Every decision he made, I believe he viewed through the eyes of sailors and Marines and soldiers and airmen and their families. What effect would it have on them? And he was committed to making sure they got what they needed. Now, I was thrilled to travel with Carl on 11 separate occasions. In fact, I was with David Lyles in Kosovo. Now, he didn't tell the whole story. It was an exhausting trip. One morning we started out at dawn and went till very late at night. And we were told we were going to a hotel. Oh, thank God. We pulled into what could be charitably described as a dilapidated two-story building. We were quickly ushered upstairs, shoved into rooms the size of a closet, and tried to sleep. But you really couldn't sleep because all night long below in the bar, quote unquote, there was raucous music, screaming, laughing, cars kept coming and going. The next morning we left, I didn't get a chance to go inside, but I would probably describe it as at least a house of questionable repute. Can't go as far as you might like. You never know where you end up when you're on a trip with Carl Levin. It was just fabulous. Carl's life was defined by family and by service. And we are all immensely grateful to have been a part of that. His loss is immeasurable, but his contribution exceeds his loss. And I am grateful to just to have known him and to be a friend. Now, our task is to take up his work with his passion, with his sense of honor and decency and integrity, and go forth and help this country succeed. Thank you, dear friend. You continue to sustain and inspire us all.
I'm kind of catching my breath. Now, virtually every morning as I wake up, I feel that Carl is still with us. He was there every morning, as we two grew up sleeping in the same room. And there each night we talked and then fell asleep, listening to classical music on 78 records. You youngsters won't know what that is. And an old record player. Every morning we got up together, snatched our breakfast, and walked to school. After school, each day we played sports together in nearby playgrounds and in our backyard. Just the two of us, playing stickball with a broomstick and a tennis ball and an old box spring as a backstop. Our beloved and very unathletic father managed to build a basketball hoop on our three-car garage, which only held one car. My wife Pamela asked me, why do you mention that? It's because we came from a very middle-class family. And our friends of different ages competed on that basketball court. Carl's friends and mine, 3 years apart, but no difference. Carl had trouble finding differences when they didn't matter. And there were occasional arguments, but always peacefully resolved. And then on weekends, our friends often joined the two of us in talking over current events with our interested father. An early venture for Carl and me into public dialogue. But our friends sometimes lost interest and went and grabbed oranges from the icebox in quantities far beyond our mother's budget. And Pamela asked me, why do you say that? Because I wanted everybody to understand there were limitations financially. Well, that was a happy, happy life that helped shape Carl's future. It was a home in which we never heard a cross word spoken between our parents. Never. Well, our personalities differed and evolved with the years, but still people confused us. We didn't dress alike. I could not possibly have dressed quite like Carl. But Carl, with his sense of humor, loved those confusions. And he had what was called a confusion file. He had a file about everything. This was his favorite one. Carl met a fellow who said to him, "Hello, Sandy." Carl asked him his name, and the fellow said, "I don't know you as well as I know your brother Carl. So tell him hello." Well, the closeness of our relationship in this background infused the 32 years, as has been mentioned, we shared in the Congress. Carl had the deepest sense of purpose. And people sometimes ask us, where in the world did we come from? Well, I think his life was truly, as I've said, an American story. He was the grandchild of refugees who came from an Eastern Europe that was often hostile to Jewish families. Maternal grandmother Gittel was put on a boat at the age of 15, by her parents. They wanted her to come to America to seek a better, safer life, knowing they would probably never see each other again. They never did. Their legacy is reflected in this splendid life and noble achievements of grandson Carl Levin. Carl's spirit is with us today as we join together to celebrate his life and his remarkable achievements. But I want to say this to each and every one of us. We know, despite all of these wonderful, wonderful tales and stories about Carl and all of his accomplishments, that memories can fade. Memories can be evanescent. So let me say to all of us here and those who are listening and everybody else who was privileged to come to know Carl, it's our charge for all and for each of us today. Indeed, it's our obligation to my beloved brother Carl and to ourselves, to keep fully alive these warm memories of Carl Levin. We must do that. We're now going to close with the memories, with the recollections of the President of the United States.
I had the honor of calling Carl Levin my friend for more than 40 years, one of the most honorable and decent people I've ever known in public life. He was brilliant, humble, and principled. Carl looked everybody straight in the eye, and he listened. He always told you how he saw it, without with honesty and respect. That's how Carl earned the trust of the people of Michigan. And that's how he earned the respect of his colleagues on both sides of the aisle, being able to get so much done. Protecting our national security, ending the use of torture, reining in the proliferation of nuclear weapons, standing up for the dignity of working people, from gun safety to holding corporate power accountable for their abuse and greed, and so much more. You know, I always love visiting Michigan with Carl. We talk about what drew each of us to public service, the civil rights movement, and how we'd each come up in local office, so the county council in my case, the city council in his. And with Carl, you knew that Detroit was written on his heart. He talked all the time about the beauty of the Detroit Riverwalk and the Great Lakes. When the Great Recession struck and our defining American industry, the auto industry, was on the brink of collapse, Carl and I worked together to help Detroit get back on its feet. And it did, because of Carl. Most of all, we talk about family. Jill and I are sending all our love to you, Barbara, to Erica, to Kate, to Laura, the grandkids, brother Sandy, nephew Andy, and your families. Despite the full life he lived, we know the void of the loss is still big and it leaves a giant hole in the middle of your chest. Despite his courageous fight against cancer, it still leaves a heavy toll. You know, Carl will always be with you, always. Just as he'll be with his friends, his former staff, the people of Michigan who love Carl so dearly. God bless you, Carl Levin, a great American, a dear friend, and the highest compliment to kid with him, I'd say, highest compliment an Irishman would give another person is, he was a good man. Carl was a good man.
Well, before I close, I feel like I owe everyone here an apology because at the beginning I didn't let everybody know where the restrooms are here, and by now you know some of us may want to know. It's just to the right as you head out. I just want to close by, of course, thanking all of you for being here today, and for everybody who is with us via live stream, and for those who are not able to be with us today. The video recording of this event will be available on the Levin Center's website. I want to thank the Levin family. I want Wayne State University and an amazing team of people, including some very, very hardworking volunteers who made this event possible. It was such a privilege to be able to do this with all of you. Everyone here is welcome afterwards to join us outside on the balcony where we'll be having a reception, and we can talk further about the incredible memories that we all have of Carl. And then for those who have time, at the Levin Center, we're going to be having an open house following that reception, just about a five-minute walk up the pathway here to the law school. With that, we're going to close with a song that was one of Carl and Barb's favorites. It is a tune sung by the incomparable Aretha Franklin. Thank you very much, and best to all of you.